بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. So my dear brothers and sisters, inshallah today I'm going to give an introduction of al-Muhalla, Kitab al-Muhalla of Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn Hazm is one of the great thinkers of Islam. As you can see, among the great people like Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Abu Hanifa, Ahmad al-Hanbal. And similarly, Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri is one of those top people in Islam who really, you know, think and, you know, make effort to understand and think properly. So inshallah, there will be, you know, introduction of his one of his main work, al-Muhalla. The way I have organized my, you know, teaching today, inshallah, so I will say something about the school of Zahiri school, and then the founder, Dawud al-Zahiri, and then biography of Ibn Hazm himself, his writings, and then his Usul, what are his Usul, how his fiqh works, because he wrote also a book on Usul fiqh al-Ihkam, fi Usul al-Ihkam, something from that, inshallah. And then coming to al-Muhalla itself, and I will be selecting some important discussion from Muhalla, especially those discussions where people have been so much criticizing Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri, criticizing him and opposing him. And then at the end of the class, I will mention in detail Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri's opinion about women's prayer in the masjid. So here he is very, very strong that women should pray in the masjid. And he thinks if women pray in the masjid, they get more reward than praying at home. So he has brought his arguments very strongly, and he criticized all the arguments of the period. It's very, very, very convincing. Some of the things I got from him, but now I read again. And then last thing is, many people have been saying and, you know, writing that Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri is among those people who support music and musical instruments. So I'm going to look actually how much he supports, and also the people who oppose him, how their position is. And in this matter, there's a hadith in Bukhari which Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri has criticized. So we will look, inshallah, how his criticism is, and the people who defend the hadith of Bukhari, how they defend in a balance. Because the problem has been with Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri, because he does not belong to any school, so all the schools, every school have been opposing him. And people did not really feel a need to find out what he exactly says and to defend him. Nobody came to defend him. People all the time just keep opposing him, and whatever people relate to him, everybody accepts. And especially in this matter, Malikis and Hanafis, because he criticized everybody, but his criticism against Hanafis and Malikis is more stronger than anybody else. So much, and no doubt in this matter, he also uses a language which is not, good language. So he's very, very harsh in his language against the people. So, that one thing has harmed him a lot. So that, inshallah, will come. But I will make effort to present the whole thing in much more balance, because he's one of the, in my favorite author I have been really influenced, and while I was in student throughout my read al-Muhalla, though I grown up as a Hanafi, but I liked his arguments very much. But it does not mean really I accept every single thing that he says. But we have to understand people in proper balance. He's a great thinker, so we should be fair. We should not be unjust to the people. So, and al-Muhalla, especially I read when I was a student in the ulama, and then, since then, I always have been referring to it. So it was easy for me to select the main issues and arguments which people have been discussing about Ibn Hazm, inshallah. So what actually is a school of people of Zahir? When people say, there has been in Islam Batiniya people. So Batiniya people are the people who say that the words have internal meaning, inside meaning, which we don't know. Then everybody comes and brings their own meaning. That actually very misleading school. Because if you become Batini, there is no way to regulate. Nothing, there is no way to regulate. Anybody can have their own meaning. Zahir school is not really opposite, but Zahir school emphasizes that you have to follow the text as it is. They follow the text properly. But they don't allow the qiyas. It means you are not allowed to do reasoning. But it does not mean they don't think and don't understand the text. Some people think really that these people take the words literally. And that's why some people in English translate the school as literalist or something like that. This is not true. Ibn Muhammad Zahiri is the man of the language and expert of all those things and philosophy and logic, and he said, and he himself makes very clear that how languages have to be understood. So he does not think that, you know, you take things literally. But what he wants to say is that when a ruling comes from the Quran and the Sunnah, you don't need to use your reasoning. Follow them as they are, but follow them with understanding, not that don't understand them. So he will emphasize you that you understand, think, and then after that follow them, but don't use any qiyas, because qiyas is false. That is the thing. He always makes clear that qiyas is false, invalid, it actually misleading. So some of this will come. So people of the school of Zahir, they just depend on the text, on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then the ijma of the Sahaba. No other ijma. And that's actually in this matter, I support them very much really, because no other ijma exists anyway. The Muhammad Tahir is very clear that the ijma, which consensus that matters, is the consensus of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and after that there is no consensus. People of the Zahiri school, they reject qiyas, analogy, like Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi, Ahmad al-Hanbal, everybody has some qiyas. Some people use more, some people less, but Ibn Muhammad Zahiri does not accept any qiyas. And actually he ridicules, he laughs at the people who use qiyas, that how they contradict themselves. So, and you can see really, when you look at his argument, he's a very strong person. People think he's a man who does not think, not like that. He's a thinker. When it comes, you can see that he finds inconsistency in everybody. And then also he rejects al-masalih, al-mursala, istihsan, and things like that. What he uses is istishab. Istishab basically means that, istishab in Islamic law is that things remain as they are unless you get any argument, any reasoning. If something is allowed, people have been using, that's fine, they let them use, unless you have any argument that it is haram. So it is not that the people of the Zahiri school, they don't have answer to every question. No, they also say Sharia is, comprehensive. It has an answer to every question. But the way answer is different from us. They don't use qiyas, but they say, no, things are halal unless you find an argument for it being haram. Things are mubah unless you find any argument for it being haram. So he used a priest. So you can say he goes for Quran, Sunnah, Ijma' and Istishab. Istishab. He denies qiyas. He denies Masalih al-Mursala. The Imam Malik has been supporting a lot. He has also denying Istihsan, which Hanafi people have a lot. So these are things he denied and rejected very clearly. When he comes to the Quran and Sunnah, he wants to understand the Quran and Sunnah like Arab people understand in Arabic language. So sometimes things are more general. And people think the meaning is specific. Ibn Hazm says, no, it's general. It actually includes every single thing. So people make specific, then they make qiyas. If you make the nas general, you don't need qiyas many times. Like for example, when the Quran says that wine is forbidden, khamr. So Abu Hanifa, rahmullah, takes meaning of khamr, something made from grapes and dates. So any drink which is intoxicative, which is not from dates or from the grapes, then Abu Hanifa will make qiyas. Another people do. But Ibn Hazm Zahiri says khamr means all the drinks which are intoxicative. So he does not need a qiyas, because his understanding of the meaning of khamr is different from you. He wants to make khamr more general. So there's no need for qiyas. So you can see that without the qiyas, he can solve all the problems. People actually did not make much effort to understand what he has been. That is why you can see every madhab, Maliki especially, have been so much against Ibn Hazm Zahiri. In Andalus, where he was grown, he was so much opposition by them. Actually, they forced him to leave his town and he was banished to a village, and so much problems in his life happened. But the man remained actually firm on his position, and Allah SWT gave him so much barakah. So, people who refute him, very often they don't make effort to understand. And since they know that you can say against them whatever you like, nobody going to question anyway, the people have been blaming them off every single thing. One of the great criticism of Ibn Hazm Zahiri has been from great Shafi'i scholar Imam al-Haramain.